Greetings. O Muslim, God has guided you to see this video so that you may hear the truth. You know how Islam struggles to prove Mohammed did not tell lies, and you know there are claims that Mohammed is referenced in the Bible. I challenge you, O Muslim, to watch this whole video because I prove that Islam falsely claims Isaiah 29:12 speaks of Muhammad. In part 3 of this series, I gave a list of scriptures Islam tries to claim mention Muhammad. Deuteronomy 18:18, Song of Songs 5:16, Isaiah 26:12, Deuteronomy 33:2, and Isaiah 42:13. Well, I made a mistake. I was wrong. I'm so ashamed. I said Isaiah 26:12, but the correct reference is Isaiah 29:12. Thankfully, my salvation does not arise from my own perfection. Like other verses that Islam twists to support Muhammad, the claim to use Isaiah 29:12 is refuted along many grounds. First, let's read the verse that Islam claims is reference to Muhammad. Isaiah 29:12, and the book is delivered to him that is not learned, saying, "Read this, I pray thee," and he saith, "I am not learned." This is the verse that Islam and its teachers try to claim is a reference to Muhammad. Let's look at the issues, the problems with this claim, one by one, and along the way let's examine why Islam wants to and tries to use it. Number one, the verse does not mention the word prophet, meaning it does not foretell a prophet. You see, when God wants to foretell a prophet, he has shown that he knows how to do that. Deuteronomy 18:15, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your fellow Israelites." Will raise up for you a prophet. Deuteronomy 18:18, "I will raise up a prophet like you from among their fellow Israelites." Will raise up a prophet. Isaiah 43, "A voice is calling, clear the way for the Lord in the wilderness, make smooth in the desert a highway for our God." A voice calling out. So if God wants to announce his prophet, his voice, his servant, he knows how and has shown how he does it. In fairness, there is no requirement that God announce a prophet. Most prophets, in fact, were not announced. The issue here is not that Muhammad was not announced. The issue is that Islam claims this verse is an announcement, a reference, a mention. But Isaiah 29:12 makes no mention of a man being a prophet, a voice, or a messenger. In fact, the reason Islam clings to this verse is one word, unlearned. This is the description Allah gave. Surah 7, 147 and 148. The unlearned prophet. So, since Islam finds the words unlearned and man in the same verse, they reason this must be Muhammad. And that is the true level of Islam's desperation. If Islam cannot find mention of an unlearned prophet, they have no proof that Muhammad did not lie. So where Islam finds the word unlearned, they see a verse they must try to twist to fit Muhammad. This verse is just one example of the word unlearned in the Bible, but Islam thinks it is twistable to fit Muhammad. So they try. Point 2. There is not one sect of Christianity or Judaism that thinks this is a prophetic revelation of a prophet to come. It is recognized as a message from a prophet, even as a message of possible future events. Two independent groups, Jews and Christians, with separate motives and agendas, read this passage with the same interpretation. And I say passage instead of verse, because it is inaccurate and dishonest to rip one verse out of context for your own private agenda. Yet sadly, this is exactly the behavior of Islam, which rips the verse 29:12 right out of its context. But not one group which reads and respects the context teaches this passage is somehow an announcement of an unlearned prophet. Except Islam, because Islam has an agenda that requires them to abuse the Word of God in this manner. Islam has no allegiance to the truth or God or the message that God sent. Islam proves this when they twist the message to insert Mohammed. Number three, the clear message of the verse can be learned from the context. This is the only honest way to respect Almighty God and His prophets and the message that they brought. Read the blessed Word of God in context. Let's read the verse in context so you too can understand the correct reading and meaning. Isaiah 29:10. For the Lord has poured out upon you a spirit of deep sleep. He has closed your eyes, you prophets. He has covered your heads, you seers. And the vision of all has become unto you as the words of a book that is sealed, which men delivered to one that is learned, saying, Read this, I pray you. And he says, I cannot, for it is sealed. And the book is delivered to him that is not learned, saying, Read this, I pray thee. And he saith, I am not learned. And the Lord said, Because this people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips, while their hearts are far from me, and their fear of me is a commandment taught by men. The clear meaning of this passage is that God has closed the book and hidden the vision. It does not matter for these people if they can read or if they cannot read. The vision, the knowledge, the understanding is closed to them. It was understood, but not necessarily liked and well received by the people Isaiah rebuked. And again, remember the desperate situation Islam is in. Islam is desperate to prove Mohammed did not lie. To defend their leader, the one they truly submit to, they must create a reference to support his claim of being mentioned. So even though the correct way to understanding is to respect the context, the goal of Islam is not understanding. It is proving Mohammed did not lie. Remember that. Point 4. Christians and Jews have known the true meaning for over 2,500 years. It's pretty arrogant and ignorant to think people 800 miles and 600 years removed get to define the meaning, especially given the fact Islam disregards the context. There is no group outside of Islam with its desperate situation who fail to understand the real meaning. Isaiah 29:11, And the vision of all has become unto you as the words of a book that is sealed. That single statement is really the core message. The rest is just explanation to get it through, to make it too clear to misunderstand. The book is closed, it is sealed. Which men deliver to one that is learned, saying, Read this, I pray you. And he says, I cannot, for it is sealed. Here we see the book given to a learned man who can read. And he says, I cannot, for it is sealed. And the book is delivered to him that is not learned, saying, Read this, I pray you. And he answered, I am not learned. The clear meaning is that God closed the book to their understanding. And the vision of all has become unto you as the words of a book that is sealed, which men could deliver to one that is learned and one that is unlearned. It does not matter whether you can read or cannot read. It is sealed to both of them. Point 5. The verse does not stand alone, but is directly coupled with 29:11. This is where Islam damns itself to error and proves its hatred for knowledge and understanding. Rather than dare to read the context, rather than dare to really respect the text, Islam single-mindedly pursues their agenda to defend Mohammed and support their claim he did not lie. But I honestly think that their approach to rape the context and assert facts that do not fit hurts their cause and proves anyone who respects knowledge and understanding has no place in Islam. Point 6. It is a prophetic passage, a message from the Prophet, rebuking a certain people. Isaiah 29:1. Woe to you, Ariel! Ariel, the city where David settled! Add year to year and let your cycle of festivals go on. Yet I will besiege Ariel. She will mourn and lament. She will be to me like an altar hearth. 29:10. For the Lord has poured out upon you a spirit of deep sleep. He has closed your eyes, you prophets. He has covered your heads, you seers. 29:13. And the Lord said, because this people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips, while their hearts are far from me. This is a judgment, a rebuke, a scolding, not a warm fuzzy message about a future prophet. Point 7. Islam builds their story around the verse to make it fit. Islam's story is that a spirit, an angel called Jibril, began to speak to Muhammad. Islam cannot even state whether an actual physical Quran ever existed written by Allah. But Islam's mythology is flexible enough that their story can change to an actual book physically handed to Muhammad. And Islam is more than willing to try and make this claim part of their mythology and fairy tales, if it perhaps gives them a credible attempt to support Muhammad's claim and prove he did not lie. But verse 29:11 specifically says who is giving the book, which men deliver to one that is learned, saying, men deliver. As Didet says,
that is amen, 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 amen.
It is not an angel. It does not say angel.
That is amen, 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 amen.
And yet when Islam tries to make this verse fit the mythology of Islam and the Quran's beginning, Islam must claim it was not a man but an angel who has given the book. But we know from the context who was handing the book to the learned and the unlearned.
That is amen, 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 amen.
It was not an angel. It could not have been Islam's Jibril. But remember, Islam is desperate to prove Muhammad did not lie. No matter how provably wrong, Islam must hold on to any sliver that they think they can convince each other refers to Muhammad. Point 8. The passage actually condemns the man who is mentioned. Remember, context matters, and the very next verse is not flattering to the learned and unlearned men. And the Lord said, because this people draw near with their mouth and honor me with their lips, while their hearts are far from me, and their fear of me is a commandment taught by men. God is speaking of all the people who are without vision. This includes the learned and the unlearned man of 29:12. Their hearts are far from me. They honor me with their lips, while their hearts are far from me. Point 10. The verse and context carries some damning implications. If Islam insists that 29:12 is Muhammad, 29:13 is also Muhammad. And 29:13 condemns Muhammad. 11. Islam finds itself in a hole of confused denial. The book of Isaiah was written by, well, Prophet Isaiah. Personally, he's one of my favorite prophets. Isaiah had a laser beam of focus that I just don't see by most other prophets. He called shots that no one on earth could have imagined. A virgin shall conceive. The voice of one crying out to prepare for God on the earth. God would give us a son called Mighty God. God's servant would die for our sins. There are more, but his clarity on topics unimaginable impresses me. And that is one reason I find Islam's theft and abuse of this verse viscerally offensive. But here is the real problem I see for Islam. Islam teaches there are 25 prophets of God. I know, what about the other prophets to every nation? But Islam can only steal prophets from Israel, because those are the only prophets the author of the Quran knew about. Adam, Enoch, Noah, Heber, Methuselah, Lot, Abraham, Ishmael, and Isaac. Jacob, Joseph, Jethro, Job, Ezekiel, Moses, Aaron, David, Solomon. Elias, Elisha, Jonah, Zechariah, John the Baptist, Jesus, and, oh yeah, Mohammed. Did you notice anybody missing from the 25 prophets of Islam? Prophet Isaiah. Islam does not respect Isaiah as a prophet of Islam. He is not one of the 25 named prophets of Islam. And I find it pretty sick that Islam will try to claim Isaiah spoke of Muhammad as proof of Muhammad's prophethood, that Mo did not lie, he was described in the Torah, when Islam does not honestly, actually, even believe that Isaiah was a prophet. But for some reason, over time, Islam has begun to recognize Isaiah. I think the disingenuous and deceptive minions realized they needed him to try and claim Isaiah foretold Muhammad, because the word unlearned happens to appear in the book of Isaiah. There really is no low to which Islam will not stoop. As I have shown, Isaiah 29:12 does not speak of a prophet. And if Islam had any regard for God, Prophet Isaiah, or the truth, Islam would have policed itself to clean up this crap claim. But my question for you, viewer, is do you have any regard for the truth? Do you want to know the truth? Do you want to follow or be part of a religion that does not respect the truth? Because I tell you now, with full respect for Almighty God, Islam has no respect for the truth or the message of the prophets. If you are a Christian, please keep in mind just how weak the claims of Islam are. Do not allow yourself to be impressed or tricked by the claims of Islam. Challenge every statement made by someone from Islam. And never, ever believe what a Mohammedan says the Bible says. They have no regard for the truth. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.